This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
Aloha, and welcome to the monthly public presentation of the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii. We're recording tonight's presentation for broadcast on the VSH television series, Vegetarian, which appears on public access channels across the state. You can also view videos of this and many of our other past presentations on our website, www.vsh.org. At last year's report, our videos of speaker talks had accumulated 1,280,191 views. As of this afternoon, they've accumulated a total of 2,036,566 views, with views coming from the United States, Canada, the United Kingdom, Australia, Germany, the Netherlands, Sweden, India, Israel, France, and Malaysia, in that order, and then there are just a few from a lot of other different countries all around the world. It's now time for a special guest. We're very happy to have with us Home Leomohala. Home Leomohala was born and grew up on the island of Maui, graduating from Lahaina Luna High School. He did leave the island for a while. He earned an Associate of Arts degree in music from Lane Community College in Eugene, Oregon. Since then, he has been many things, including an ocean reef lecturer and whale watch naturalist, a snorkel and hiking guide, cruise director on the Navatek II, and educational director for Leilani Farm Sanctuary. He also served a 5-year internship with a vegan community dedicated to promoting planetary integrity. He is the president of OLA, the Optimum Living Alliance, a nonprofit 501c3 organization dedicated to promoting personal and planetary vitality, and the curator of Onipa'a Sustainability Center, a project of OLA dedicated to sharing the facets and benefits of sustainably directed lifestyle options. Presently, he is developing several books focused on evolving the human character. He lives in Haiku, on the beautiful island of Maui, with his wife Heaven and their son Koa. Home Leomohala's presentation tonight is entitled Environmental Benefits of a Plant-Based Diet. Please join me in welcoming Home Leomohala.
Thank you, Leilani.
Thank you.
Oh. Mahalo.
So just a little bit about me, just to get you guys acquainted. I pretty much grew up on the island of Maui, as Lorraine shared with you. My father is Hawaiian. I was born and raised in Lahaina, Maui. And he often used the expression, no hanu ino da aina, which is a broken Hawaiian pidgin way of saying, don't desecrate the land, which I interpret as care for the land, or aloha aina, as we are often heard saying today. And this care for the land is something that's been imbued in our culture for quite some time, and I'm very happy to say it is being perpetuated to this day, including our state motto, ua mau ke ea oka aina I ka pono. In case you didn't know, means the life of the land is perpetuated in righteousness. So we're all learning to do that. I realized at a young age that taking care of the land didn't mean just taking care of this island. It meant taking care of the whole planet, because we're all connected. Everything is one. What happens here affects there, and what happens there affects us here. So, with all that in mind, I'd like to go ahead and kick it all into gear. The way I look at things, we live in an incredibly amazing world. Everywhere we look, we are surrounded by miracles. whether we are fortunate enough to be immersed in nature or exposed to technology, art, and architecture, it can all be quite spellbinding. In the midst of all of this magic and wonder, we are also becoming aware of the plights of our environment and the suffering that is happening elsewhere in the world. Unaware of the connections, the root causes of these maladies, we tend to feel unempowered or disempowered to help alleviate them. But as we grow in our awareness of the connections that our personal lifestyles have to either the healing and nurturing that is happening in the world or the suffering, we grow ever more empowered to effectively modify our lifestyles in a way that supports personal and planetary prosperity. I believe that good decisions are only possible with the attainment of good information. My intention tonight is to share with you vital information that will support you in the making of healthy decisions for your life. My assurance is nestled in the fact that each of you has chosen to be here tonight with a willingness to consider the information being presented. For this, I am deeply grateful. My hope is that I'm able to reward your willingness with something that you will find valuable and applicable for your lives. We're going to start with water. We're going to take it one element at a time. If all the water in the world were represented by 1 gallon, all the drinkable reserves in the water would be represented by just 15 drops. Our water supplies and the sanctity of those water supplies are being consumed and contaminated at an alarming rate. For example, in the Sahara Desert, the average person consumes about 20 gallons of water per day. That includes for sanitation and agricultural purposes. In Europe, it's about 10 times that much. And here in America, we consume about 17 and a half times the amount of water as the average person in the Sahara. Why so much more water than them? Well, for starters, the grain that is being demanded to feed our appetites for animal products is enormous. The total water to feed livestock and produce a pound of product is correspondingly colossal. The water to produce a pound of vegetable product ranges from 25 to 50 gallons, with apples being one of the most water-intensive crops. A pound of chicken requires 16 times more water than a pound of apples. A pound of pork, 32 times the amount of water. And 1 pound of beef requires over 100 times the amount of water than 1 pound of apples to produce. What this amounts to is a lot of water consumed. And not only is it consumed, it's also contaminated. How much more water do meat eaters consume than vegetarians? If a vegan left their shower on all day, every day for a full year, they would still consume less water than the average American omnivore. So we are saving significant amounts of water. Now, we're not only consuming water, we are contaminating water with our dietary practices, especially animal consumption. As you can see by the steaming mountains in the background here, there is a lot of excrement that is being produced by animal agriculture. It is estimated to be about 2 trillion tons per year. Again, as testified by these steaming mountains in the background here.
Steaming mountains of what?
Steaming mountains of what? That's a great question. Can you guess? Manure, that's a wonderfully tactful way to put it, yes. Yes. Yes, kukai in Hawaiian. Mahalo, hey, aka mai e you. Yeah. So the livestock population not only consumes a lot of water, it produces a lot of waste. The intense amount of water used to attempt to control sanitation only serves to deliver the contaminants into our public water sources. According to the Environmental Protection Agency, livestock produce 20 billion pounds of excrement a day, or 250,000 pounds per second. In other words, if we had a silo twice the size of this room, it would be filling up at the rate of 1 foot per second. And so in the time that it took me to explain that to you, we'd already be over our heads in this stuff. That's how much is being produced right now. The immense amount of water used to attempt to control sanitation conditions only serves to deliver the contaminants into public water sources, according to the Environmental Protection Agency. Livestock practices have imposed health risks to many nearby and not so nearby communities. Present-day animal agricultural practices are permitting contaminants to enter our public waterways. Allowing rivers to become flushing mechanisms to is creating coastal dead zones where the waterways deposit contaminants into our seas. If you look at the very bottom, see this little red thing right here? That's the Mississippi River, Gulf of Mexico dead zone. Here's a close-up of it. This is an 8,000 square mile region of uninhabitable, lifeless ocean. And that is due to the contaminants that are being deposited into the Gulf of Mexico via the Mississippi River. These are popping up all over the world. And they're pretty much popping up wherever agricultural practices are using rivers as flushing mechanisms. So abstaining from meat and dairy products would help to alleviate further contamination of our waterways. Now we move on to air. Air is the thin veil of vapor that blankets all life on Earth. It is within this thin, frail film that everything that we know of that is alive on this planet exists. As we contribute to the overall composition of the atmosphere, we influence the behavior of our global climates. For those who still don't believe that human activities are controlling climate destabilization, you should know that there is virtually no debate in the scientific communities. The only debate is in the media, which is owned and operated by corporate entities who would suffer greatly if potential patrons, such as you and I, knew that our consumer spending was contributing to climate destabilization. What does this have to do with plant-based benefits? Everything. The World Watch Institute released a report that showed that the amount of greenhouse warming gas released by driving a typical American car in one day is about 3 kilograms. The amount of greenhouse warming gas to produce beef for one U.S. hamburger is 75 kilograms. In other words, to offset the footprint of one hamburger, I would have to avoid driving my car completely for 25 days. How many people can get by without driving your car for 25 days? No problem. Good. I'm glad some people can. That's great. How many people think one burger is worth either the carbon footprint or the month of immobility? No hands? No hands. Okay. How big of a deal is the way we eat? The percentage of greenhouse gases produced by all modes of transportation combined is about 13%. Recently, new reports have come out showing that animal agribusiness has a carbon footprint of somewhere around 51%. That's just shy of 4 times the amount of all the cars, trucks, trains, planes, and boats in the world combined. The carbon footprint of all modes of transportation. So what does this mean? It means that a vegetarian in a Hummer, here comes my vegetarian in a Hummer, has a smaller carbon footprint than an omnivore in a Toyota Prius. Now, of course, what all this means is not that you should go get a Hummer once you've gone vegetarian, but that you can shrink your carbon footprint even more with a vegetarian diet and a high mileage per gallon vehicle. Of course, you can improve on this by using a bicycle or just using those feed skis. All right, but for maximum carbon relief, go vegetarian. So pervasive were these facts that several cities and at least one country are making commitments to go vegetarian. The Flemish city of Ghent has announced VeggieDog, here comes VeggieDog, or Veggie Day, where its citizens are encouraged to abstain from eating meat one day a week to help emphasize the impact that it has on global warming. In Sweden, food labeling has been implemented to help consumers recognize the contributions their consumer choices are making on global climates. This is expected to help reduce carbon contributions by about 20 to 50%. When they learn that the average omnivore contributes about 1.5 tons of carbon to our atmosphere every year, the country of Taiwan created a bill. It's called the No Meat, No Heat Union. 1 million people, including members of parliament, have signed this petition, vowing to be complete vegetarians and thereby reduce humanity's greenhouse gas footprint by 1.5 million tons annually. Again, it's called the Union of No Meat, No Heat. I heard Taiwan gets a round of applause for that. Nice. Fortunately, the trees of our planet, and more specifically the forests, assist us in alleviation of global warming by drawing carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and pulling the surplus back into the earth. This helps to stabilize the greenhouse gas buildup and normally would avert global warming. Unfortunately, we are shooting our rescuers in the roots with our present eating habits. This is a picture of a forest that has been denuded in order to allow grazing for America's pursuit of meat. Howard Lyman explains, "Humanity is rich in folly, but it's hard to think of a folly more mind-bogglingly stupendous than that of transforming infinitely rich, diverse, dense jungle into desert in a few years' time for the sake of a few more hamburgers." In 1960, Central America had 130 square miles of rainforest. 25 years later, it had only 80,000. And this was actually published almost 30 years ago. So that's even less now. About 1 acre of forest is being cleared every 1.5 seconds, according to Leslie Taylor in her book, The Healing Power of the Rainforest. It is as if a raging fire were devastating everything in its path at the rate of 1 acre every 1.5 seconds. To help keep perspective, imagine this raging fire here on Oahu. It would wipe out an area the size of Honolulu in 10.3 hours, 10 hours and 20 minutes. So, in other words, if it started now, an area the size of Honolulu would be completely wiped clear by the time you wake up tomorrow morning. And this is what is happening every hour of every day, the last several years, and is still happening. The present rate of destruction, the Brazilian rainforest will cease to exist by 2040, according to Howard Lyman. After deforestation comes desertification, which is a global problem. More than one-third of the Earth's land surface has been desertified to some degree by livestock grazing. According to United Nations experts, deserts are expanding globally by 27,000 square miles annually. How much is 27,000 square miles annually? Well, the Big Island of Hawaii is bigger than all of the other Hawaiian islands combined. 27,000 square miles is about 7.5 Big Islands of Hawaii all becoming desert every year. And that's how much of our planet is losing its fertility. Which brings us to, well, reforestation. Fortunately, there's good news. According to Cornell economist and David Fields and associate Robin Herr, 1 acre of trees are spared every year for every person who transitions to a completely vegetarian diet. In other words, if you were to go completely vegetarian today, and some of us already are, 1 year from now, there will be 1 acre of pristine rainforest somewhere in the world with hundreds of intact life forms still thriving on it. It will have your name on it, as it says, thank you. Meanwhile, with deforestation and destructive agricultural practices comes topsoil erosion. According to Carter and Dale from their book, Topsoil and Civilization, wherever soil erosion has destroyed the fertility base on which civilizations have been built, these civilizations have perished. The animals whose lives we dominate were originally evolved to be regulated by nature. Our practices of locating them in unnatural environments is serving to destroy the natural composition of the soil. This, along with synthetic soil enhancements, is causing our nutrient base, our soil, to decay. 200 years ago, American topsoil was 21 inches. Now, it's about 6. Like pharmaceutical junkies, we have been trying to address our soil infertility issues by synthetically fortifying our soil with chemical fertilizers in excess of 20 million tons per year. That is more than the combined weight of every man, woman, and child in America. It does nothing to extend soil longevity. Over 4 million acres of cropland are being lost to soil erosion every year. Again, topsoil is the nutrient base upon which all societies, plants, animals, and human, are dependent for their existence. Supporting animal agribusiness practices through unconscious consumerism implicates us in the contamination of waterways, the destabilization of our atmosphere, the destruction of forests, the desertification of regions, the depletion of vital topsoil, and all of this leads to the destruction of habitats. This is a picture of the Amazon rainforest. After the loggers have come through, taken down the forest, the ranchers have come through and used the land for grazing for somewhere around 5 years. And then come the miners, the strip miners, who then devastate the land and ravage it for precious materials. What's left behind is lifeless, sterile, contaminated rubble, which will require many years before the plants and the forests can begin to replenish themselves. The area of tropical rainforest destroyed for the production of each fast food hamburger made from rainforest beef is about 55 square feet, and that is about the footprint of one giant kapok tree. Can you guys see that tree in the back behind this guy? This tree, not $2.35, is the true cost of a hamburger. With habitat destruction comes the loss of entire species of life. 10,000 species are presently being lost every year. That's about one species, not individual lives, but life forms that we have been evolving with on our planet for millions of years, is disappearing every hour. In the next 10 years, over 1 million species will have become extinct. According to the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization, the fisheries of the world, also known as the oceans, have been 75% exploited, and the large fish of the sea have been 90% exploited. Our fisheries, our fishing systems have successfully pillaged the seas, and there's basically a fraction of the teeming menagerie of life that once was, only 50 short years ago, remaining. It has also been said that our oceans have become so contaminated that all fish are presently said to be laced with varying amounts of contaminants, such as PCBs, mercury, dioxin, lead, and most recently, radioactivity. And this leads to debilitating illnesses for those who eat the fish, and at most risk is the unborn fetuses of pregnant mothers. Farm fish is not a viable option because many of the farm fish are fed ocean-caught fish, up to 5 pounds of ocean-caught fish for every 1 pound of product produced. What is the true cost of extinction? I call on Chief Seattle to offer his perspective. If the beasts were gone, man would surely die from a great loneliness of spirit. In much of our modern-day spirituality, we often say that Creator, Source, or God is imbued in everything around us. Yet in our pursuits to connect with divinity, we frequently overlook our lack of reverence toward those who we share our existence with. And Christopher Flavin, president of the World Watch Institute, offers this perspective on the benefits of plant-based living. He says, there's no question that the choice to become a vegetarian or lower meat consumption is one of the most positive lifestyle changes a person could make in terms of reducing one's personal impact on the environment. Little do people realize that even our sacred economy is deflating in large part due to our patronage of animal agribusiness. In a normal, healthy economy, investing into a commodity would return a value that is at least equal to or greater than the initial investment. Our patronage of animal agribusiness is proving to provide otherwise. If the cost of water to produce meat were not subsidized by the U.S. government, the cheapest hamburger meat would cost more than $35 a pound, according to John Robbins. The cost efficiency of supporting animal agribusiness is an inverse scale. In other words, the more money we invest into it, the more we need to keep spending in order to rectify the maladies it creates. Let me show you what I mean. The money we spend on animal agribusiness amounts to hundreds of billions of dollars that we spend collectively. The dividends received after allocating enormous sums of money into meat and dairy production amounts to extremely compromised health, more sick leave, less productivity, and impaired cognitive performance. That's initially. Maintaining a meat-centered diet will lead to increased chances of heart disease, cancer, osteoporosis, diabetes, and several other debilitating afflictions, all of which leads to increased medical bills and spending for healthcare. Our present national healthcare market is approaching $3 trillion per year. In national healthcare spending, America ranks in number one in the world, but according to the World Health Organization, we rank no better than 72nd of the healthiest nations in the world. Our present diets are not only making us incredibly sick, they are killing us. They are also costing us trillions of dollars in remedial treatments. Massive petroleum consumption through transportation of water, grain, animals, production of petroleum-based fertilizers, insecticides, herbicides, antibiotics, and steroids means greater carbon emissions, which contributes to climate destabilization. As you recall, our carbon footprint by patronage to animal agribusiness is four times that of all transportation in the world combined. So we are, animal agribusiness is definitely a significant contributor to climate destabilization. In 1980, weather-related disasters was almost $3 billion. In 1985, weather-related disasters cost us over twice that much. In 1990, that number again more than doubled. By 1995, it again more than doubled. All of these figures have been calculated to account for population growth and inflation. They're calibrated for the dollar value in the year 2000. In the year 2000, our annual environmental havoc bill was costing well over 20 times the amount that it cost 20 years prior. Accounting for the averages of the years in between shows a recognizable trend. And in 2005, the doubling trend again. Water dependency, consumption, and contamination are also having economic impacts. Again, without a reliable nutrient base, and topsoil erosion. Without a reliable nutrient base, civilizations can either resort to pillaging someone else's land or perish. The third option is to eat lower on the food chain, or maybe that should be the first option. Right, if water subsidies were withdrawn from California livestock producers, the income of the state's other businesses and workers would rise over $10 billion annually, according to economist Douglas McDonald. Bear in mind that this is just the water subsidies for just the state of California. Imagine what the dividends will add up to when we have collectively taken such measures nationally and globally. Not only will we begin to look like a more economically healthy society, we will actually get healthier physically, which will supremely supplement our economic revival. UCLA economists David Fields and Robin Herr report that without the burden of the meat market, healthcare savings could amount to over $10 billion within 5 years, and possibly much more. Continuing, they add that water subsidy savings could be $80 billion and up to $200 billion in 20 years. This means that we could have more money available to invest in home restoration and improvement, more funds available for education and college tuition, more financing available for community centers, parks, social services, senior centers, community gardens. We will have more in our county, state, and national budgets for developing alternative energy systems and their supportive infrastructures, as well as the establishment and management of wilderness preserves. We will have more time to enjoy our lives in good health with our children, our families, our friends, with freedom from financial worry. But the benefits don't stop there. Every year, millions of people die due to starvation. The opportunity to feed the hungry of the world is presently within our reach. In order to do so, we must first understand two of the key factors contributing to food shortages. Howard Lyman, a fourth-generation cattle rancher, explains one of them. Around the globe, wherever the onslaught of ranching is felt, forest is lost, native flora and fauna face extinction, streams and rivers are polluted, soil erosion worsens, topsoil blows off in the wind or runs off overgrazed hills, dust storms arise, and nature plots her revenge in the form of desert. And with desert comes famine. Each and every single meat eater requires about 3.25 acres of agricultural land to support their personal diet and lifestyle. Those who limit their animal intake to milk and eggs require 0.5 acre. A genuine vegetarian, one who consumes no animal products at all, requires less than 1/6 of an acre. Why? Because a complete vegetarian will eat the food that is grown directly from the earth, but a milk, egg, or meat eater takes the food, the grain and vegetable matter, and processes it through an animal, allowing that animal to grow and burn off many of the calories in the food before it is then eaten as flesh. The livestock population in America consumes enough grain and soybeans to feed over five times the entire population of the country. They are fed 80% of the American-grown corn and 95% of the oats. By doing this, we acquire 10% of the calories that went into feeding the livestock. To put this into perspective, imagine going to your bank and handing them $1,000. Leaving it in there for an appropriate amount of time, you would expect to be able to come back and withdraw your $1,000 with interest. Instead, they hand you, say, a $100 bill. This is the nutritional equivalent of processing our food reserves through livestock. Not only do we diminish the quantity of available food, we also diminish the quality. All right, enough grain is fed to livestock every day to make two loaves of bread for every man, woman, and child on earth. Wouldn't it be nice if this were the case? Unfortunately, it's not. This is. We're feeding our grain to animals. So here's what is really happening due to our present practices. Every year, over 60 million people starve to death. Most of them are children, about 40,000 a day. This comes out to one child every 2 seconds. And here's what that looks like. Right now, somewhere in the world, this is actually happening. Right now, somewhere in the world, another child has just perished due to a lack of food, of which there is no genuine shortage. One child every 2 seconds. And that's due to our appetite for meat. But here's their hope. As you may recall, here's their hope. The Council on Agricultural Science and Technology says that we could manage to feed 10 billion people with the available cropland we have today using current technology, with the single proviso that the population of the world becomes vegetarian. You see, for every egg and dairy eater that transitions to a completely vegetarian diet, three more will be fed. And for every meat eater who transitions to a completely vegetarian diet, 20 more people will be fed. Here is where hope for humanity comes to life. Federico Garcia Lorca, the Spanish playwright and poet, states, "The day that hunger is eradicated from the earth, there will be the greatest spiritual explosion the world has ever known. Humanity cannot imagine the joy that will burst into the world on the day of that great revolution. We will give our children something to smile about, as well as our children at home, all of our children. We could all jump for joy with the knowledge that neither our health nor our happiness are dependent on anyone else's suffering or death. Concerning our prospects for peace in our lifetime, things are looking up. A plant-based diet and lifestyle has the potential to profoundly promote global harmony in several different ways. St. Francis of Assisi once noted, "If you have men who will exclude any of God's creatures from the shelter of compassion and pity, you will have men who will deal likewise with their fellow men." Pythagoras, celebrated mathematician, also who was also a vegetarian, by the way, noted that as long as men massacre animals, they will kill each other. Indeed, he who sows the seeds of murder and pain cannot reap joy and love. And Louisa May Alcott, the celebrated American author, abolitionist, and emancipationist, once noticed that without flesh diet, there could be no blood-shedding wars. As long as we permit violence in our food choices, we are more prone to permitting violence in our world. Some examples of violent food choices are beef, pork, chicken, seafood, fish, eggs, and dairy products, to name a few. And these can be easily categorized by noticing that they're all something that came from a mother. Allowing violent food choices into our homes allows us to tolerate other forms of violence and others, and still others. Bill Hom, the CEO of Kansas City Farms National Slaughterhouse, candidly shares the common slaughterhouse reality in this interview. He says the slaughterhouse is not a very pretty thing. It's not now and it never will be a very pretty thing. Animals come there to die, to be eviscerated, to be decapitated, to be dehydrated, and all those are violent, bloody, and difficult things to watch. So your first and foremost impression of at least the initial stages of the packing house are very violent, very dehumanizing sort of thing. In the following interview, a former slaughterhouse worker shares his experience. For reference, the stick pit is the place where the animals receive their first incision. It is in the stick pit. You're going to kill it, only you don't just kill it. You go in hard. You push hard. Blow the windpipe. Make it drown in its own blood. Split its nose. Now this, believe it or not, is actually common procedure. The next part is actually not common procedure or standard procedure, but it's not an uncommon trait of those in his position. He says, a live hog would be running around the pit. It would just be looking up at me and I'd be sticking. I'd just take my knife and cut its eye out while I was just sitting there. Not anything anyone should be proud of. According to statistics, it is not at all uncommon for slaughterhouse workers, active or retired, to continue with acts of violence in society. Also, a society that assumes violence as a necessity of its existence is condemned by its own oppressiveness. Leo Tolstoy explains it simply. He says, as long as there are slaughterhouses, there will be battlefields. Now, the following slides are intended to help illustrate this point. However, they are about as graphic as this presentation gets. So for anybody that would feel imposed upon by direct images, I invite you to go ahead and prepare yourselves accordingly. This is the reality of the slaughterhouse, as is this. Will Tuttle, Dr. Will Tuttle, offers this perspective on our treatment of animals. He says, like a ball being held underwater, our natural compassion wants to come bubbling up to the surface. So we must continually work to keep it repressed. This submersing, stifling, and stuffing down of our natural compassion causes us to harden empathically. Because of this syndrome that our culture has embedded into many of our psyches, much of humanity has become desensitized to the sensations around us, and hence disconnected to the lavish abundance that we are immersed in. Nobel Prize laureate Albert Schweitzer offers this simple perspective. Until we extend our circle of compassion to all living things, humanity will not find peace. It's nice to know that neither our health nor our happiness are truly dependent upon anyone else's suffering or death. Indeed, throughout history, our personal well-being has always been enhanced as we have evolved to alleviate ever more oppression and suffering in our world. Peace, both inner peace and global peace, will come when we have relinquished the acts of violence that we presently permit in our own homes. Rachel Carson, the author of Silent Spring, put it this way. She says, we cannot have peace among men whose hearts delight or condones the killing of any living creature. By every act that glorifies or even tolerates such killing, we set back the progress of humanity. Many of history's great minds have shared vegetarianism as a common trait. Pluto, Socrates, Pythagoras, Da Vinci, Newton, Einstein, and Gandhi, to name a prominent few. I would now like to explore some of the evidence supporting why this would be so. Benjamin Franklin, one of America's renowned thinkers, once wrote, "My refusing to eat meat occasioned an inconvenience, and I have been frequently chided for my singularity. But my light repast allows for greater progress, for greater clearness of head, and quicker comprehension." Here are some statistics that give credence to such a claim. Independent surveys show the IQs of US children is averaging 97, but isolating for vegetarian children produced an average IQ of 116. To begin understanding the nature of these statistics, let's take a quick look at the brain. Our brain basically developed from the base to the front. At the base is where our more primal instincts like survival emanate from. At the front is the most recently developed part of our brain, the hippocampus, which is where intellect and more complex processing is said to take place. Here now is testimony from researchers illuminating how thought processing can be enhanced by a choice of diet. Stanford University professor Bruce Lipton. In an emergency, the vascular flow and hormones serve to activate the hindbrain, the source of life-sustaining reflexes that most effectively control fight or flight behavior. While it is necessary that stress signals repress the slower processing conscious mind to enhance survival, it comes at a cost. Diminished conscious awareness and reduced intelligence. Robert M. Sapolsky, a neuroendocrinologist, continues the thought. He says, sustained stress can damage the hippocampus, the part of the limbic brain which is central to learning and memory. The culprits are glucocorticoids, a class of steroid hormones secreted from the adrenal glands during stress. They are more commonly known as corticosteroids or cortisone. Cortisone has a variation known as cortisol. Sapolsky continues. Cortisol also interferes with the function of neurotransmitters, the chemicals that brain cells use to communicate with each other. Excessive cortisol can make it difficult to think or retrieve long-term memories. Now, the body runs on two types of fuel, glucose and fructose. The brain only uses one of those, glucose. Stress hormones divert blood glucose to exercising muscles. Therefore, the amount of glucose, hence energy, that reaches the brain's hippocampus is diminished. So let's recap that last section. We can see that cortisone shunts blood to the hippocampus. Less blood, less oxygen. It diverts blood glucose to exercising muscles, less fuel. Stifles neurotransmitter function, which is like getting poor reception on your cell phone times several billion brain cells. Hence, the cumulative effect of excessive cortisone is reduced intelligence. Here to tie all of this in with our choice of diet is nutritional physiologist and researcher Erwin Putzkopf. He says, stress, fear, and pain when animals are being slaughtered or waiting to be slaughtered results in several disease processes in the humans who eat the meat. What's causing all these problems? Primary substances include adrenaline, cortisone-like secretions, and steroids, which stimulate fear pheromone production. He says this study confirms this link in food consumed by humans. So, what exactly is the connection between animal consumption and our mental health? To help clarify this, let's take a look at the source. This is a cow on her way into the slaughterhouse, and that's it. We're not going to get any more graphic than that, okay? She has been hearing, smelling, and is now seeing the carnage as the cows before her are shot, slung up, skinned, and dismembered, mostly while screaming in horror. She is next in line and mortally terrified awaits her turn. At this moment, every fiber of her being is working and fighting to save her life. She is pumped up with adrenaline and cortisone in the interest of finding the strength and maybe even the strategy to escape a gruesome death. Should she fail in her desire to survive, to live, the survival hormones that her body will have become saturated with will then become locked into her flesh. This is true of all animals, whether we are cows, pigs, donkeys, horses, ducks, geese, or humans. We all secrete survival hormones, such as cortisone and adrenaline, in our struggles to survive. So, scientific research, some of which I've just shared with you, suggests that human consumption of hormone secretions from, like cortisone, from the flesh of animals can contribute to emotional stress, irrational fear, also known as paranoia, hostility, which can contribute to family dysfunction, and most significant in this case is impaired cognitive performance, also referred to as reduced intelligence. Will Tuttle, who wrote The World Peace Diet, offers this perspective on the omnivore's compromise of intelligence. He says, the suffering we inflict on animals is just as real and painful and urgent to them as our own suffering is to us. If we discount their suffering at our hands and say, but they're just animals, then we sow seeds of hard-heartedness and numbness that reduce our intelligence and tend to bring misery, destruction, and disease into our lives. It has been said that as we oppress others, we imprison our own hearts. Albert Einstein wrote, "Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circle of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature and its beauty." We've heard about the negative chemical effect that eating animals has on intelligence. Will Tuttle and Albert Einstein have shared a bit about its spiritual compromise. And there also happens to be a mechanical framework of compromised mental acuity associated with animal consumption. You see, intelligence can be measured by our ability to perceive reality accurately. Many of us once perceived the sun as traveling around the Earth, but in terms of astronomy, calendar accuracy, and presently space travel, we find that it is far more accurate to perceive the Earth as orbiting around the sun. This is a recognizable improvement in accuracy and intelligence, because it permits us to more effectively achieve the results we desire. This axiom holds true whether we are trying to build a sandcastle, or a skyscraper, put a man on the moon, or create world peace. Having a more accurate perception of reality allows us to more effectively and consistently achieve the results we desire. Therefore, if any person were to attempt to discount or ignore a recognizable facet of reality, such as the fact that animals do feel pain and do suffer at our hands, then we would be exercising a trait known as self-imposed ignorance. Self-imposed ignorance is, by definition, a reduction of intelligence. Galileo, upon experiencing this syndrome, once remarked, "I do not feel obliged to believe that the same God who endowed us with sense, reason, and intellect has intended us to forego their use." And Socrates noted that the highest realms of thought are impossible to reach without first attaining an understanding of compassion. Which brings me to the final chapter of this evening, compassion. There are many ways that a plant-based diet and lifestyle supports the expansion of compassion. I would like to highlight just three. First is compassion for the indigenous people of our planet. Within every culture, there is an inherent wisdom. Indigenous people are no exception. Indigenous people normally have very fulfilling lives. In their natural settings, they have fresh air, water, food, shelter, a strong sense of community, artistic expression, joy, and a bond with the earth that eludes most urbanites. The children have a deep sense of community cohesion. Play comes naturally and easily. Social rejection isn't anywhere near the severity that urbanized people have created. Kinship and fellowship amongst the villagers runs deep. They have an innocence and a wisdom that is unique to them, and whether we recognize it or not, precious for us. When we patronize animal agribusiness, we are contributing to the destruction of their habitat, the disintegration of their way of life, the loss of their culture and wisdom, and ultimately the enslavement of indigenous people. Buddha, "The eating of meat extinguishes the seed of great compassion, from which we can infer abstinence from meat nurtures the seed of great compassion." The second facet of compassion that a plant-based diet and lifestyle supports is for that of non-human animals. The unbridled joy and unconditional love that flows so generously from non-human animals has a value for us far greater than any slab of their flesh on a plate could ever provide. They, like us, have a need for comfort, nurturing, and play. They, like us, have feelings, desires, whims, and joy. They do feel pain, anguish, and sorrow at the loss of a beloved, and great elation upon their return. They think, they feel, and they do have a spiritual contribution to offer. This ability to think, feel, and care is known as sentience. Reverence for sentient beings cultivates benevolence in the human heart. The examples that we set for our children today set the templates for their characters tomorrow. As we grow in our compassion, they grow. As we expand our circles of concern and care, they easily emulate them. As our joy is cultivated, they don it. readily and easily. Plutarch, the Greek moralist, once said, "With only to learn benevolence to humankind, we should be merciful to other creatures." Violence is a breach of a pact of trust. When violence is present, trust is suspended. Trust will resurface when violence, being untrustworthy, has been discarded. Trust can be regained. Trust is often just waiting in the wings. Trust in the animal kingdom is actually quite common. Trust opens the doors of connection and acquaintance and friendship and camaraderie and conversation. Trust opens the doors of play and affection and caring and devotion and tenderness that can warm the coldest heart. Trust opens the doors of nurturing and joy and exploration and intimacy and joy. Oh, and romance and maybe even remorse. Distrust precludes fear. Assurance reawakens trust and reopens the doors of connection. When violence, being untrustworthy, has been discarded, trust will be revived. Can we learn from their examples? I believe so. As we become more trustworthy, as we become more intimate with the tenderness in our hearts, nature's children accept us readily, and we experience what some people might have thought unattainable. As we learn to look into our hearts, we may find the connection that we have been seeking isn't nearly as distant as we may have thought. Alice Walker, the author of such works as The Color Purple, has this to say about the status of animals in our society. The animals of the world exist for their own reasons. They were not made for humans any more than black people were made for white, or women created for men. What is possibly one of the most significant evolutions in the history of humankind is our ability to empathize with the plights of others and to expand our circles of compassion. You see, the expansion of compassion has been a boon for humanity. The ongoing trend of abolition, emancipation, and liberation from separatist beliefs have served to deliver us to a more nurturing standard of conduct and hence a deeper sense of peace. As this trend continues, we will surely find ever more nurturing standards of conduct and the resulting deeper levels of peace for ourselves, our loved ones, and the generations to come. In this way, animal liberation is synonymous with human welfare. And the final benefit that a plant-based diet and lifestyle offers for the expansion of compassion is that of our future generations. The destiny of our future generations is presently in our hands. As we learn to extend our circles of concern and care, we afford others the joy that is their birthright. The love that all mothers have for their children is universal. Our future generations and their mothers are depending on our sensibility to care about the world that they are given. They need us to shift our perceptions and to reconnect with the sanctity of life that we are immersed in. The children of tomorrow are looking to us to recognize the impact that our present lifestyles are having on their world and their lives. Their hope lives in our ability to reach out and broaden our scope of reverence and kindness to include evermore of creation's children. The awe-inspiring beauty that once was is in great peril. The wonder and majesty that we have been graced with is in jeopardy. You see, when corporations place their immediate profits as a higher priority than environmental sanctity and pre-assessment of the detrimental impacts of their operations, catastrophes occur. And catastrophes are occurring. Profits, it seems, have become the golden egg, if indeed the holy grail, of corporate, political, and social pursuits. And it is this exact syndrome that is contributing to many of the maladies that we are now facing. So how do we resolve these issues that we and he are now facing? Uncle Albert has a little light to shed on this. He says we can't solve our problems with the same thinking we used when we created them. So let's think about that for a moment. Presently, many of us have come to believe that our welfare and our security are dependent upon the whims and the mercy of corporate and political structures, and that our safest behavior is remaining within the corporately and politically prescribed realms of propriety. But as we gain a clearer understanding of the framework of corporate structure, we find that we are empowered to guide it. Every day, we make personal decisions as consumers. Collectively, our consumption influences industrial behavior. So the question is, what type of conduct would we like industries to emulate? There are many characteristics to consider. Now, encouraging reform and legislation, as many of us do, is all very nice. But if that is all we do, it is still very much akin to asking someone else to solve the problems that we are creating. If we sincerely want things to change, then eventually we will have to start doing things differently. Gandhi said, "You must be the change you wish to see in the world." Essentially, what it all boils down to is we have a choice. We can either continue with our casual and widespread consumption of our planet and hand our future generations a wasteland, or we can embrace the wisdom that we have been so generously graced with and create a world of symbiotic, thriving, prospering life, which includes us. I trust that with the proper perspective, we can choose wisely and easily. Thank you.
Hey, Ryan. Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much, Homelio Mohalo, for a very compelling presentation, and I think yours is a really powerful message that needs to be heard. I'd like to invite all of you now to get some of those great refreshments from Down to Earth over in the kitchen there. Thank you again for coming, and have a safe return home. Good night, everyone.
This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.